Jay Hagedich, and thank you for taking time to join us this morning. I'm Jay Hodges. I'm a friend of Shem Fain, and I want to thank you for tuning in again for another interview. Today, we're going to have a conversation with award-winning filmmaker, Belfast proud son, Mr. Sean Murray. Sean, how are you doing?
I'm doing fine, Jay. Thanks for having me.
Ah, man. Thank you for taking the time. Now, your films include The Wall, Ballymurphy, Fractured City, which you won a Royal Television Society Award, Unquiet Graves, which is the topic that I really want to get to this morning. You also won an award for that. For anybody who doesn't know, that's the story of the Glen Ann gang detailing how members of the RUC and the UDR were centrally involved in the murder of 120 innocent civilians. And so we're going to get to that. You're also a director for a film company, and you just have kind of a lot of stuff going on there. So without further ado, I kind of want to jump right in and get right to talking about everything. Can you, people aren't going to really know about you. They're going to know your films, but they're not going to know about you yourself. So can you talk just for a couple minutes about where you were raised, kind of what went on and those things?
Well, Where I'm sitting now in my office is Conway Street. It's just right on the peace line between the Falls and Shankill Roads. It's an interface area. So the wall separates, both the Clonard area and the Lower Shankill area. So I was born here and grew up here in Clonard, and I work here. My office is here. So living in Clonard during the conflict, I mean, growing up in the 80s was pretty volatile around here, because we have obviously the Lower Falls, which Clonard is an area that comes off the Lower Falls. So it was always a very volatile kind of area. There was a lot of shootings, a lot of bombings. Almost every male member of my family either were political prisoners, or my uncle Don, for example, was killed in Gibraltar. So we were a very political family. We were always very politically active. I never seen much of my father growing up. Most of my childhood, my father himself was in jail. And then when he came out of jail in 1987, he wouldn't have stayed much with us in the house because of the loyalist attacks and what have you. So we were always the family was always very politically active, and the area in general was always, there were a lot of political characters that came out of Clonard. So that's how my own politics was shaped. And why I'm now involved in political filmmaking.
Now, I want to talk about your family, but in particular, I want to ask about your grandparents, because there's this great scene in The Wall, which is a very short documentary. It's about 15 minutes or so long, but it's really amazing. It's just a great deal. But there's a story where you're talking to your dad about your grandparents and about that area that you were raised in, but also that he was raised in. Can you touch on that just for a quick second?
Yeah, well, The Wall, it's a short documentary that I had made as we were approaching the 50th anniversary of the pogroms in 1969. So I wanted to look back on how we were viewing that 50th anniversary, how we had seen it as a community. But I was also interested on seeing how the other side of the wall seen it, the unionist side, because we're inclined to look at things from our own perspective without giving much thought to the other side. So really, I had framed the documentary through the prism of my own family. My great-grandmother was a Protestant from the Shankill Road. She then converted to Catholicism, and then didn't see much of her Protestant family after that. So my great-great-grandfather then would have been British Army and Orange Order. So you had this dichotomy, this one half of the family coming from that side of, on the Shankill Road. And then, of course, the Republican side of the family, Irish Republican side, So there's a great story of when she would have been very, very young during the first pogroms in the 1920s. Of her standing with her family looking into the Clonard area from the Protestant side in the pogroms then, which happened, because our area obviously has the large Clonard Monastery, which the Loyalist gangs tried to burn in 1969 again in the 69 pogroms. And then how you look back on that was 1920, when she would have been a child looking into the Clonard area. But in 1969, she had her own family. Her Catholic family was then looked into Lower Shankill as the Loyalist mobs once again try to burn the area to the ground. Obviously standing with her young Republican family trying to defend the area from the Protestant Shankill Road. So if you can visualize the imagery of that, it's quite a story in itself, you know.
Yeah, that's an amazing story of just one life being affected on either side of an issue. Now, you're an amazing storyteller with your films. They move really well. They're easy to follow. They also don't leave a lot of questions of you know, continuity and those kinds of things. And I absolutely love that. I think you're a great storyteller. But what led you to making movies as opposed to doing another way of telling these kinds of stories? Why films?
So I was always interested in film. I was always interested in storytelling. But I think it was particularly documentary. So it would have been in my own childhood in the 80s. Obviously, our own community here in West Belfast, we would have been censored. So the media was a powerful tool that was used against my own community. So we had Section 31 in the Republic of Ireland from 1971 until 1994. And then we had the UK broadcast ban, which effectively censored our community within, you know, the UK broadcasting framework. So I grew up in a period of censorship. And then there was the first time I'd seen a filmmaker called Arthur McCaig, who was from New Jersey, lived in Paris, between Paris and Belfast. And he was an independent filmmaker, a radical filmmaker who made stories, the detailed stories within my own community. So here you had this American filmmaker for the first time telling it how it was for me. And that really opened my eyes to film. It really opened my eyes to those marginalized stories being platformed, you know. Although Arthur McCaig's films, in a way, had, you know, they were viewed by the British as propaganda films, we always would have had his films in cassette, which we would have had to hide from the British Army when the British Army came in and were raiding our homes, you know. So there's a great story that I once told, and I actually detailed it in my own PhD, was Arthur McCaig's films. We would have say, for example, 40 minutes into a cassette, a VHS cassette, which would have been cartoons as us as children, we then would have had Arthur McCaig's film play after 40 minutes. So there was this one occasion when the British Army had put all our family, just as the Israelis do now with the Palestinians, put the young family, me and my siblings, into the one room. And they would have been upstairs, obviously, doing what they were doing, raiding the house. They were going through the cassette tapes to look for propaganda videos, and they had put a Casper the Ghost cartoon cassette in, and I remember them playing this through for around 30 minutes and then putting the Casper Ghost out and putting another video in. But for that sense of empowerment for me as a child, knowing that this British Army guy doesn't know in another 10 minutes time one of Arthur McCaig's films, Irish Laws or The Patriot Game, is about to play, you know. So it was always that sense of empowerment, and it really struck me the power of documentary. You know,
it's funny. After you told that story, I was actually later on that day just sitting on the couch doing some work, and it dawned on me that somewhere there's a soldier who's watching this documentary going, damn it, like I got thwarted by an 8-year-old. Like, that's so embarrassing. I think that's fantastic. So he's obviously an influence, but who else influenced you? Who else drew you into this kind of stuff?
Well, I think for me, and it was a very personal thing, it was the killings in Gibraltar in 1988. My Uncle Dan was one of the IRA volunteers that was killed in Gibraltar. But what happened then was that there was a British investigative journalist called Roger Bolton, who's also a documentary filmmaker. And they had got to the eyewitnesses. They went to Gibraltar right away and had interviewed eyewitnesses to what had happened, that the three volunteers were executed. And this debunked the official version of events from the British, you know. And I remember Margaret Thatcher boldly trying to stop the documentary, which then went to, I think, the High Court. And the Roger Bolton's crew eventually won out, and the film was aired in October 1988. So there was that real sense of how documentary can challenge those official narratives and challenge those hegemonic views, you know. So that for me, that was a big moment for me when I'd seen the part of documentary, you know.
So let's talk about Unquiet Graves, because it's been out now for a few years, but I'm shocked at the number of people who have never heard of it and who have never seen it. And I encourage everyone to go and watch it. It's really gripping. Let's first talk about the story that you tell in it, but then I want to get into kind of how it came about. So set the stage of what the story is.
Well, the story of On Quack Raise is about the Glen Allen gang. So effectively, this was a gang who had a joint membership of Loyalist paramilitaries, the RUC, which were the police force, and the UDR, which was the biggest regiment in the British Army at the time. So these were by night soldiers and policemen, or sorry, by day soldiers and policemen, and by night Loyalist gunmen. And the story of the Glen Allen gang details 120 civilians plus who were killed by this gang. So it looks at a period between 1972 and 1978 where this gang were very active. They were also responsible for the greatest atrocities in during the conflict in the Dublin-Monaghan bombings, where 34 people were killed. So this was a gang who operated between counties of Armagh and Tyrone, but also in the Republic of Ireland. So for me, the series of killings around the Glen Allen gang was something that I thought that I could tell a story, but it would also tell the story of other issues or other stories of issues of collusion. And once I had seen that Anne Cadwallader had released a book called Lethal Allies.
Yeah,
It was then that I'd made my mind up and approached Anne and asked Anne if I could meet the members of the Padfinucane Centre and the families, and I had an idea for a film. So really, it snowballed from there, you know.
And I want to just make this point because I think it's important. Like, these are law enforcement officers and military personnel carrying out executions. You know, those that we hold to protect us are actually making attacks and going at people. And it's it was a subject matter that I was very uncomfortable with just from my own life to go in and view. But when watching it, it's really... it really kind of grips you. Like, you do an amazing job kind of bringing it in. Like, how do you, I don't want to ask this, how do you do that? Like, how do you make a subject matter that is as disgusting as what this is to be something that is so interesting and so easy to understand and follow? Because it's a really, it's gripping. The whole way through it is gripping. And so I'm curious as to kind of how your process works to tell a story like that.
I think the biggest problem with On Quack Raise was that there was so much information. So it was really how to whittle that information down. You know, I couldn't, I'd said to the families from the outset that I couldn't have, you know, every family speak in the documentary, obviously. Yeah. But what I did say was that one story was everyone's stories. And what I intended to do to make the film as appealing or as internationally appealing was to collaborate with a number of great artists. So let's bring an editor in. I wanted an editor to be an Englishman because we assume too much with the politics here. And I needed someone who was removed from that, who could stop me and say, you know, what, you know, because we know all these acronyms like this, you know, the UDR, the UVF, you know.
Sure.
For an American audience or an international audience, you know, I would assume that they would know that. But of course, they don't know a lot of these acronyms. So to have someone come in fresh, like John Phillipson, he was from Newcastle upon Tyne, to work with me was a major help. Also to bring in a number of artists like, you know, illustrators and animators. Peter Strain, the animator, which has seen the animation in On Quack Raise, was very, very powerful. So for me, the main issue around a number of these documentaries before was that they were sort of current affairs documentaries, and I didn't want to go there. I wanted this to be creative and I wanted it to be artistic because I didn't want this film being another documentary that preaches to the converted. I wanted it to reach outside the conventional audience that these documentaries got to an artistic appreciation of those events, hence the animation, hence the Seamus Heaney poem, and hence the collaboration between a number of different artists. And I think On Quack Raise done that well.
When you make a film like this, do you ever have moments where you're like, we shouldn't do this? Like, we should stop. Like, this should not, we should this should not be moving forward? Like, do you ever question what you're doing?
Well, it took 4 years, but I'm very, very stubborn. No time did I say it wasn't getting made. And I remember members of the Pat Finucane Centre and Anand Kadwalar said at the time, you know, I know that people were having doubts and people didn't have the faith that I did. And that's completely understandable because it took 4 years. But the reason why it took 4 years is because I knew I was going to do it. And I didn't care about the time because I was going to get it right. And I was going to have the proper people on board. You know, having Stephen Ray on board from the racing, having that animator on board, waiting for the money to try and raise some more money for exactly how I wanted that animation to be, took another year. But at no time did I ever doubt that we were going to finish the film. You know, I didn't anticipate it to do as well as it did internationally, and to have as much an effect. But I did strive for that. You know,
I think that's beautiful. And total, as an artist, I just think that's incredible. After the film came out, or even right before the film came out, was there any immediate backlash that gave you concern? Like, were there moments where you were like, "Oh, this isn't. We're gonna have to back up a little bit."
No, because during the filmmaking process, we had two films which were released, which had seen the reaction from unionism. It was 66 Days, the Bobby Sands film, and also No Stone Unturned. So I was expecting a similar reaction from unionism and the unionist media. But what had happened when Unquiet Graves was released, it was quite muted. The newsletter, which would be the most vociferous of a detractor in the case of these films, was very, very muted. Belfast Telegraph, in a kind of way, which is another unionist newspaper, kind of promoted the film. You know, their articles were friendly, and I didn't understand it. But I think, again, it was artistically made so different from other documentaries that it was quite hard to criticize and unpick the content that was within the film. So that was July 2018. But if we forward 2 years later, after the film had done an international tour, had been in film festivals, had been through all those advocacy screenings with the families all over Ireland, the UK, Europe, we had the decision by RTE to screen the film. And this changed everything, because we have to frame this historically when we look at RTE as being one of those institutions and as part of the establishment in the south of Ireland who censored these types of works and censored those marginalised voices within our own communities. So I think that was too much for unionists. It was also too much for the right-wing press in the south. And that's why we'd seen those ad hominem attacks on myself. We'd seen these smoke screens that were thrown up, but still they didn't challenge the content within the film. They personalized it. They made the story about me being a Republican, coming from West Belfast and making these types of films that the documentary was based. But of course, this fallacy of objectivity about documentary has always been there. Every documentary that's made has a social or political content, and is made as a counter to any official version of that. So, for to say that a documentary is biased, whether it's a BBC documentary or whatever else, there's no objective documentaries, none at all.
So, in addition to the response that you got there, was there any response that you got that was just very shocking, of just either positive or negative, just responses that came in where you were like, I was not expecting that?
Yeah, I think when I began to see the number of newspaper articles from unionist newspapers, it was orchestrated. So there was like two articles a day for a week from different unionist politicians, former special branch men. So they had this all lined up. But I had also known that this small cabal of ex-journalists, politicians, and others were trying to stop the screening of Unquiet Graves behind the scenes. But I think it was really when we had seen Charlie Flanagan come on board with his criticism, the former Justice Minister in the Republic. When I'd seen that, I'd said to myself, they've really lost their discipline here. The discipline that they kept in July 2018 was blown away with Charlie Flanagan on board, because that not only exposed the fact that Unquiet Graves had rattled the system both North and South, but it also exposed the relationship between Fine Gael and the Unionists, because everything that Charlie Flanagan had said and his detractions was almost verbatim what the Unionist newspapers were saying in the days before.
Interesting. And what about its reception outside of Ireland? You know, you screen this thing all over the world. It's a global film at this point. What kind of shocked you about, you know, it being shown in Kansas City, or it being shown wherever, kind of around the world? Were you prepared for that kind of a response, or was it something that you just kind of thought, well, that's, you know, that's kind of different?
Yeah, but you know, I was really surprised at the number of screenings. You know, I definitely thought we would get an Irish American audience. You know, we know that we can do these things through advocacy because we have that support. That support base is there through friends of Sinn Féin, through the Vernians, you know, many of the Irish American organizations, and in Australia and stuff like that. But it was the number of screenings that kept going, you know. And to be quite truthful, I mean, me having to leave Ireland to go to Canada and to go to Australia, then Canada, then the USA. I was traveling for months. I couldn't physically keep up with it. It was just so exhausting to be traveling so much with it. And there came a point, actually, I was in Sydney, and I just arrived in Sydney, and I was told that I needed to do a radio show from Sydney to Toronto at 3 a.m. And I think it was one of those times, you know, because I'm traveling everywhere by myself, you know, and it was one of those times I went, we've really done this. What I had said to the families, what I'd hoped to do, we've really done this. It was just one of those woozy moments, you know.
That's awesome. So I encourage everyone to watch this film. I can't sing its praises enough and the impact it's had on me personally. But what's next for you? What are you currently working on? What are you looking at coming down the road? Like, what's up for you in the future?
Well, I'm just finishing the new documentary on the death of Dr. David Kelly. So Dr. David Kelly was the Iraq War Weapons Inspector who worked for the Minister of Defence in Britain. And of course, he was found dead under suspicious circumstances just after the outbreak of the Iraq War. So it's a major case over here. That was 2003. So 17 years later, so the documentary is looking back on what had happened around that time, and questioning again the official version of events. So the official version of events, according to the Hutton report, which Tony Blair had organized at the time, was that he had died by suicide. So we are looking at that and we are saying, you know, the information that we have here and that we are transmitting through this documentary debunks the official version of the event, that it would almost be impossible for Dr. David Kelly to commit suicide.
Wow. When can we expect to see that roughly? I know you don't have a permit.
We're hoping that's going to be released March, April 10th, but definitely spring. So we're in the edit now at the minute and we're almost finished. So yeah.
Oh, great. Perfect.
Yeah.
Now,
and of course we have the follow-up to Unquiet Graves, which is already in pre-production, you know.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that one. You're doing a follow-up on that.
Yeah, we're doing a follow-up to Unquiet Graves. So it's looking at the 1980s right up to the IRA ceasefire in 1984, concentrating on the change of strategy by the British in focusing more on extrajudicial killings against Republicans, but also how that went hand-in-hand with Loyalist killings, particularly in East Tyrone. And the killings in many ways became more grueling and targeted, you know, pregnant women, old people in their homes, etc. So it was a change of strategy from the British. That's how we frame in this new documentary. You know?
Wow. You're in pre-production on that one. So I will eagerly wait for that and then look for your Dr. Kelly documentary in March. Now, just, you've been an Irish Republican your whole life. Your family's been very active and whatnot. Brexit is obviously coming to a head this week. I know you're not a Brexit expert, but kind of what are you thinking the future holds for the north of Ireland and whatnot? Like, what are your thoughts on the matter?
I just think that Brexit has hastened the possibilities of a unified Ireland, you know. So I think through all the chaos, I think good will come out of it. I think that it's needed something like this, you know. And of course, we've witnessed the Brexiteers been either thrown out or something's happened behind the scenes. We've got Dominic Cummings leaving, those Brexiteers leaving Downing Street. I think in part due to the new administration in America. I think that the British, in particular Boris Johnson, has to reevaluate the whole Brexit situation with the new American administration, because obviously they won't view things as kindly as Trump would have. So it's very, very interesting times, but I definitely think that we are in positive times through all the chaos.
Good. I love to hear that. Now, my last question for you is one that I ask everybody. Aside from your work, if you bumped into a stranger on the streets and they said, I want to know more about anything, like what's the book that you tell them to read? What's the album you tell them to listen to, or the documentary you tell them to watch? Like, what is it that you would encourage people who want to know more outside of your own work that you would encourage people to go to?
My favorite book of all time would be Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee. It's a book that I've read so many times.
Really?
Yeah. I love that book. I think it's a metaphor for today's society, you see. So I just think it's something that I would constantly read. But I would also advise viewers to read, and I see this from many people, to read the works of your enemies. Because on too many occasions I've said to people, I won't read that because such and such has wrote that book. I've just bought a book by a guy called William Matchett, and I'll just get the book for you.
Bury Me at Wounded Knee.
Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee.
Yeah, that book, we read that book in, I want to say junior high or high school. I'm from Kansas originally, so like the where I'm from, that's a very typical read for a lot of kids. I think that's fascinating that you had read it all the way over in Belfast.
Yeah. So as I was saying, you know, I haven't read it yet, but I've just ordered a book from William Matchett, who's a former special branch man, who's wrote a book called The Secret Victory, The Intelligence War That Beat the IRA. Now, Matchett had done an interview, or done an article in the Belfast newsletter on the release of Unquiet Graves. Again, trying to debunk many of the stuff that was in. And what he had done was he had written that article without actually seeing the film, as most of them did. So I would always...
As all good arguments go.
I would always ensure that I had read as much as I can on whoever that I'm trying to criticize before I make any criticisms on. So that would be my 2p, if you'd like, on that. So what I hope to do is read the book and give my own assertions or my own viewpoint on the book. But from what I hear, it's not a very good book anyhow.
I don't think you should read the book. I think you should just offer your critique of it and say, if, you know, turnabout's fair play, and go about there. That's hysterical. I hadn't even seen the movie. Well, that's amazing. Thank you so much for taking time to come talk to us today. I encourage everybody to see your work because I think it's so amazing. You're a great storyteller. You have an amazing attention to detail, which is just great. They can find Unquiet Graves where? Like, where can we send people to find?
Just go to www.unquietgraves.com. You get as much information as you can from there, you know. So I think there's also on that website an offshoot of any articles that's been done on it also. There's a connection to the Twitter account and Facebook account and stuff like that, you know. So, and even if you Google Unquiet Graves, there's many of the articles that are for the film and many of the articles that our detractors have written from the film was released on RTE, you know. So there's loads of information out there.
Okay. Well, thank you again for taking time to come talk to us. I certainly will look forward to seeing what comes out in March. And I hope you have a great day. Please stay safe, and we'll look forward to seeing you soon.
Thanks very much, Jay. Thanks for having me.